Hi, I'm Joe Marola. I'm going to be discussing the topic of addressing disease progression in psoriatic arthritis, optimizing targeted therapies. Again, I'm a dermatologist and rheumatologist here in Boston. These are my disclosures. And these are the learning objectives for the session. We're going to do a little bit of level setting around psoriatic disease, particularly because we have an interdisciplinary group. And then we'll take a little bit deeper dive into what treatment looks like in 2020 and beyond, and a little bit about the data that supports our use of the agents we'll be discussing. So I'm going to start with a case just to get people sort of excited about psoriatic disease and the sort of challenges that we're faced with. So we have a 45-year-old woman who has psoriasis, diagnosed at age 25. She's referred to her rheumatologist with 2 years ago for psoriatic arthritis and was given adalimumab at that time. She has a number of typical comorbidities of psoriatic disease. You can see some of her medications. And on exam has pretty severe skin psoriasis. You can see a body surface area of 20%. In addition, she has dactylitis. She has heel pain and back pain. So we might already be suggesting here that she maybe has enthesitis, which we'll talk about, or inflammation at the site of tendon insertion into bone, and back pain, which would prompt us to think about whether this patient might have axial involvement or sacroiliitis, for example. And she complains about the joint pain as well as her skin symptoms. Interestingly, she has a family history with a mother who has multiple sclerosis, and we'll see why that might be relevant a little bit later. So this is a summary of some of her findings, including her exam, which does suggest axial involvement, does indeed suggest enthesitis on exam. She has dactylitis. On x-ray, she has hand erosion and damage, and has some confirmation that she likely has axial disease or sacroiliitis. And really, I think the take-home high-level point of this is the myriad manifestations of potentially of psoriatic arthritis, the potentially damaging disease that one can have, and the impact on quality of life as shown by the patient's PROs. And so how do we start to pick apart a case like this? How do we start to approach therapy? So we're going to take two steps back and just show you a little bit of the pathogenesis so you understand where these therapies sort of come from and fit in. This is a really nice review article from Chris Richland and folks that was in the New England Journal. It gives a nice summary of where you can see some of the key inflammatory players are, both the innate immune system as well as adaptive immune system and relevant cytokines that are really a shared pathogenesis between the skin disease, as you can see in the top left, as well as then the manifestations of psoriatic arthritis in the synovium, in the bone, and at this synovio-enthesial complex enthesial junction. And I think, you know, the what I would just focus attention on is, in addition to the skin disease, there is the story of the microbial dysbiosis in the gut that may play into this. There are also obviously genetic factors not listed here that predispose the patient to the psoriatic diathesis. And ultimately, the cytokines that lead to this cascade, where you can appreciate where a lot of our current targets exist, right? So a lot of these cytokines have become quite familiar to us when we think about the therapeutic landscape and what has become really, we believe, central to the pathogenesis of disease. This is also a nice review of skin disease. We're obviously going to be focusing on psoriatic arthritis, but the point of this was to show where some of those interventions, for example, anti-TNF therapies, anti-IL-17 therapies, IL-12-23, IL-23, and missing from this, but we'll talk about on the next slide as well, are other interventions that impact these same downstream cytokines, such as JAK inhibitors, for example, sort of increasingly seen and new to the scene. And impactful on psoriatic arthritis. And this is really just a refresher slide on JAK inhibitors. And, you know, there's variable selectivity of many of the agents that we have listed here and that we'll be discussing. In particular, worth pointing out tofacitinib in psoriatic arthritis, already approved for psoriatic arthritis. And you can see the sort of selectivity profile that's suggested here for tofacitinib. We'll be talking a little bit in our discussion today about, in particular, upadacitinib, as well as the BMS drug listed here. That's a TYK2 inhibitor, and how those are facing psoriatic disease. Just a reminder that the variable selectivity is probably a bit dose dependent in many of these drugs, and you can appreciate which cytokines are preferentially targeted through these variable JAK inhibition mechanisms. So I guess moving from two steps back to one step back, we have the barriers to early diagnosis, treatment initiation, and optimal management. So what, you know, how do we start to address some of the diagnosis of psoriatic arthritis and then ultimately build a framework for considering treatment strategies? And so there are some challenges to getting patients to the right diagnosis and ultimately to the right treatment. So the heterogeneity we underscored at the very beginning, the fact that there are multiple different variable domains of disease involved, you know, some folks who have axial disease, others who have predominantly enthesial disease, or you know, a variety of patterns of disease that can make you know, the diagnosis challenging. The fact that we don't have a diagnostic test, that it remains a clinical diagnosis. Awareness of PSA is still not at its peak. And so, you know, among non-rheumatologists, like, you know, us, I'll put my dermatology hat on for a moment. You know, we have to really have this at, you know, at the front of our minds whenever we're seeing a psoriasis patient, and really think about screening. So screening for the non-rheumatologist is really a key element. We'll think a little bit about who the particularly at-risk group are for developing psoriatic arthritis, although I would say anyone with psoriasis is at risk. And then what are the treatment options? And, you know, and the challenges there are when we're choosing an option, we don't really have an ability right now in 2020 to predict which mechanism is the right one for a given patient. There are variable responses by domain of disease. So, for example, not every mechanism treats axial disease, or they variably treat other manifestations. There are a number of potential comorbidities, as we saw in our case, that should be factored in. Perhaps a patient has fatty liver disease, and obesity and alcohol use, all comorbid, and that might, for example, challenge our use of methotrexate. And then, of course, access to therapy, which is a challenge that we all face and our patients face. So this is just a summary of some of the manifestations of disease. We mentioned peripheral arthritis, which can come in a number of different patterns: oligoarticular, polyarticular, symmetric, DIP, joint involvement, et cetera. We have the potential for axial disease, enthesitis, as mentioned here, this inflammation at the site of tendon insertion, dactylitis, or the sausage digit, with inflammation in the joints, the tenos synovium, as well as the intervening soft tissue, as shown here. You can also see and appreciate some of the nail changes in that picture of dactylitis. Of course, the skin disease, which has itself many different potential manifestations, and then nail disease, as shown here with onycholysis, pitting, and also pretty strongly tied to psoriatic arthritis, as we'll mention. This is an interesting slide because even with this breadth of disease, there's still more heterogeneity to unpack behind each of these sections, just to give you a flavor of some of the diversity of disease that we might be dealing with. And remember, upwards of a third or more of our patients with psoriasis go on to develop psoriatic arthritis. So it's not uncommon. Even within there, anywhere from 30 to 50% have been reported to develop, for example, axial disease. So we have to think about prevalent disease when we approach these. We know that we're not doing a great job in dermatology. According to a couple of studies, this one suggests that upwards of 40% of the patients in this particular study had undiagnosed or previously undiagnosed psoriatic arthritis. And so we really need to be screening if we're not a rheumatologist. And what are the features that would raise a red flag? So again, I think anyone with psoriasis is at risk, but there are a few skin features for the dermatologist in particular to be aware of that may increase risk. So this is a publication from our group, a group of my colleagues and myself that look at risk in this disease. And so scalp disease, inverse or intertriginous disease in body folds, which is often forgotten about, is a very important one for the rheumatologist to know about as well. nail psoriasis, and you can see family history, I think, is another key element that actually very strong predictive risk having a first degree relative with psoriatic arthritis. And why does it matter? It matters because we know that a delay in diagnosis is associated with worse outcomes, with erosion, with damage, with impact on functional disability. And so, you know, getting patients to a diagnosis early is important and really can prevent damage and dysfunction ultimately. Okay, so we finally arrive where we're meant to be at the current and emerging treatments. So you can see and appreciate here that the landscape of treatment options in 2020 is pretty broad. And so, you know, there's a lot to talk about. And obviously, we have to talk about how we can help our patients navigate such a crowded landscape. Everything from traditional DMARDs, still facing and still variably used for psoriatic arthritis, through what many would argue is has been first-line therapy for psoriatic arthritis, the anti-TNF class, including based on some of the ACR guidelines and other guidance. Newer targeted therapies, including, and in particular, the IL-17 class, and then in development, a number of drugs that are poised to be facing psoriatic arthritis, some at any moment. And then, of course, you know, older treatments that still really help us put out the fire from time to time or manage more mild disease, including NSAIDs, steroid injections, et cetera. So this is a slide that has to be taken with a grain of salt, but I had updated this a number of years ago just to try to get a sense of where some of our classes of agents tend to fall with regard to domains of disease. And so it's certainly not perfect, but just to give a sense of where some of these classes fall, you can get a sense of what is either approved for or thought to work well for peripheral arthritis, for the skin disease, for axial disease, et cetera, across the board. I include here GI IBD because of the co-prevalence of IBD among psoriatic disease patients and for our GI audience of interest. And I would say it certainly comes in to our factoring of agents not infrequently in clinic. And so I think that's an important one to think about. One in particular I want to highlight, I mean, you'll see across the board some of the anti-TNF treatment across the full breadth of domains of disease, similarly with the IL-17 class. The one that is really of interest, I think, because it's a hot topic, are the P19 inhibitors. And, you know, we've seen, and we'll go through a little bit about some new and exciting data that suggests that the P19 inhibitors may in fact be facing psoriatic arthritis as well as being very robust skin treatments. And so that's really a hot new bit of data over the last couple of years that we'll unpack. So I get this question not infrequently, what about methotrexate? How do you use it? Does it have a role? I won't have time to go into it in great detail, but I do think it's worth highlighting the SEAM PSA trial that got a lot of press. This was a look at etanercept versus methotrexate versus etanercept plus methotrexate combination therapy. And really the high level result here was that there really didn't seem to be any benefit to the combination therapy over etanercept monotherapy with regard in particular to some of the psoriatic arthritis domains of disease. And one of the things that are hard to assess here because we don't have a placebo arm, but was suggested is that methotrexate still seemed to look pretty good by the numbers alone. Of course, we don't have a placebo comparison group, but it was a bit of needed data to sort of revive the discussion about whether methotrexate fits into our psoriatic arthritis algorithm. This is, if anyone's interested, a little commentary I had the pleasure to write with my colleague Alexis Ogdi, a little bit talking about what the methotrexate piece might look like from this study, if there's interest. And so let's start by class. We're going to go through some of the data and have a look at how this landscape plays out in terms of data. And so anti-TNFs, first line mainstay of therapy in our patients with psoriatic arthritis. And I hate to oversimplify this, but I think it is helpful to have a frame of reference for our, you know, our other looks at some of the newer data. And you can see from some of the pivotal trials what the ACR 20/50/70 data looked like, and then skin data that was from the psoriatic arthritis trials. And so you have to also realize that the skin data embedded within the psoriatic arthritis trial is not necessarily representative of that in the psoriasis dedicated skin trial. So we may see some lower numbers there than we would expect in the skin trial. But really focusing on the ACR 20, which I think many know is a composite measure that looks at joint disease, includes patient-physician global pain, among other things. So we really get, we do get a sense of the breadth of disease, but more facing sort of the peripheral arthritis. So we don't have in that same wrapped up score, any information about enthesitis or axial disease, say directly. So it is a little bit more limited, but still what we're stuck with in terms of assessment. And so you can see the ACR 20 numbers here, around 60 or so percent. These are not comparative trials, but just a summary of data side by side. ACR 50, around 40%, and ACR 70, around 20%. And so for those who are not familiar with this field, some will call this the 60-40-20 rule here around the ACR 20/50/70. And I think while it's crude, it is a benchmark for us to start to think about looking at some of the other treatments. I won't spend a lot of time on TNF therapies, but I want to move on to some newer data for folks. So here we have the IL-17 data. Importantly, this is ixekizumab data. And if we have a look here, these are biologic naive, largely patients in this study. You can get a sense of where the drug falls with regard to ACR 20, 50, and 70 data. Again, we see these nice robust responses both at the Q4 and what was here, the Q2 week dosing. Remember our 60-40-20 rule, we certainly meet that here. Very robust numbers. We don't have time to go into skin efficacy data, but really tremendous robust skin clearance data with this class of medication and with ixekizumab. And so, very much facing our psoriatic arthritis patient, as well as axial disease and enthesitis data, all very positive. So really facing the full breadth of psoriatic arthritis. We rarely get a look at head-to-head psoriatic arthritis data. We have a number of psoriasis head-to-head trials, but here we have a rare look in the SPIRIT head-to-head trial with ixekizumab versus adalimumab in patients with skin and joint disease. You'll notice the composite outcome here of ACR 50 plus PASI 100 at week 24. And so, without unpacking the individual components, you get the sense that there's pretty robust data here with regard to ixekizumab compared to adalimumab at this 24-week time point. There are some criticisms about, the driving elements here. Is it, is it skin-driven? Is it psoriatic arthritis-driven? But again, I think just worth knowing that these studies are out there for a deeper dive. And give us a sense of where these may fit in our treatment algorithm. Secukinumab, very briefly, we see, again, very robust data. We have the 300 milligram, 150 milligram, and that slightly, you can see the slightly lighter yellow shade, and then placebo. And so I would focus your attention on the ACR 20 response here. You can see among a TNF naive and TNF IR population what these data look like. Here's our sort of 60-ish percent ACR 20, which does fall off to some degree with anti-TNF IR. This is the case with, I would say, most agents that we'll be looking at, that there's some drop off in the TNF IR population. And then you can see very robust skin responses. Again, remember, these are the skin responses embedded within a psoriatic arthritis trial. And so, expect higher and responses and probably better data from their psoriasis trials. Comparison of secukinumab versus adalimumab. Again, we have rare head-to-head data. This is one little cut of data that looks at ACR 50 and PASI 100. I'm using this just to juxtapose against that SPIRIT head-to-head data that we saw a little while ago. Here are the numbers at 24 weeks. Here are the numbers at 52 weeks. You'll notice that this is not statistically significant, but you get a sense that there's a trend at least toward, if not better responses, then at least certainly suggesting that these are as good in the psoriatic disease space as say adalimumab, and really have become for many a follow-up therapy, certainly a potentially first-line agent when we're thinking about treatment of our patients with psoriasis or arthritis. Sort of hot off the presses is not the data, but the excitement around bimekizumab, which is an IL-17A and F inhibitor. This is slightly older data as we await some newer data around from their psoriatic arthritis phase 3 program, but really showing very early phase 2 excitement around what seems to be very robust responses in terms of ACR 20 and ACR 50 responses. Their primary endpoint actually pushing the envelope with an ACR 50 response rate. And you can see that some of these numbers are really even above what we might have expected traditionally from the ACR responses. And so, waiting with bated breath for their phase 3 data and to see where this will fit in with our algorithms. Their skin data looks incredibly robust and was presented actually at the recent AAD meeting in 2020. So very important data. This is a rare look at, I think as many know, we typically learn about how our drugs will face axial disease by extrapolating from ankylosing spondylitis trials and axial spondyloarthritis trials. But here we have a rare look at how secukinumab fares in patients with psoriatic axial disease, specifically in the maximized trial. So certainly worth highlighting here. And what we see is based on the ASAS 20 responses across the 300 milligram and 150 milligram dose, a very nice and statistically significant response to secukinumab over placebo at their primary endpoint. And so, again, just really suggesting what I think we believed from the axial data, that this was a drug facing axial PSA, but now having that, that confirmation, I think is very important. IL-12/23, again, older, a little bit older mechanism now, facing, certainly still facing skin disease and with a little bit more modest efficacy data when we look at psoriatic arthritis. This is out to week 52 and in anti-TNF experienced patients. So right there, we do have to couch our interpretation of the data with the population we're talking about. But you can see, a little bit less robust ACR 20, 50, 70 data with ustekinumab, and then their skin data with regard to the context, again, of a psoriatic arthritis trial. But I use that to juxtapose with some of the newer P19 data. And this is actually very exciting because the Discover program and guselkumab have really opened up a new chapter, I think, in our discussion about where this mechanism will fit in psoriatic arthritis. So it's very exciting to see this data. Whatever we had was extrapolated, I think, from the ustekinumab data. And to me, this is really, I think, a bit of a, I would consider this a different mechanism than what we've seen with ustekinumab. We see very robust data here with regard to ACR 20, 50, 70, a little bit of a higher placebo response rate than we might have seen, with older drugs. But this is sort of a bit of a feature of some of our newer trials and to be expected in arthritis trials. This is much higher than we are used to, for example, a placebo rate in a psoriasis or skin trial. But again, very robust ACR 20/50/70 data. We start to get a look at some other important data here. In particular, I think for, say, the dermatologist, you see enthesitis resolution. And I think enthesitis is a domain of disease that's very much facing the non-rheumatologist, all of the soft tissue disease that happens in our patients with psoriasis that may be sitting in or never make it to the rheumatologist. And so this is very important for us, as a group to have looked at the MDA data, which I like very much, like a psoriatic arthritis composite measure that really faces many of the domains of disease that are important to our patients. And again, at week 24, we can see separation here and some good numbers with regard to that endpoint. So overall, very encouraging results, not yet approved, but poised to be approved for psoriatic arthritis anytime. And so very exciting data from them. A little bit more granularity with this new mechanism looking at radiographic progression data. So at least at the 24-week time point, they were able to show radiographic progression in a statistically significant way at with a Q4-week dose. However, the Q8-week dose, while you may see a trend, was not statistically significant. So, you know, more to come on this story in terms of how we may use it in facing our patients with more aggressive disease. And a very important and very exciting point, even though we have some limited time, I want to just bring up this very high level important point that while not a primary endpoint of the study, and not a, I should say, a dedicated axial study, even more importantly, this was a an important look at a subset of the patients within the study who had axial disease. Just a sense, very high level, that on the BASDAI and spinal pain scores, that there was an improvement shown with guselkumab, with this P19 mechanism at week 24. And I think that really opens up a very important dialogue, as we've seen ustekinumab and possibly risankizumab in the past, another P19 inhibitor, seemingly not show activity in the spine. This really has been a bit of a paradigm reshift and asking the question of whether these will in fact face axial disease after much negativity in the field. And so this is very provocative data, and I think we'll see more about this over time. PDE4 inhibition, just for completeness, bit older data, but looking at the ACR 20 data for apremilast, you'll see the 30 milligram BID dose here with much more sort of modest efficacy numbers in the joints. So again, you know, probably at least in my practice, facing maybe more slightly more mild disease, we don't have any suggestion of axial improvement, and we don't have radiographic progression data for this particular agent. Certainly has its role, again, for certain patient phenotypes. JAK inhibitors. So I'll start with tofacitinib, where we can see here the ACR 20, 50, 70 data for the 5 milligram and 10 milligram doses here. I think very important to point out as well what the placebo rate looked like in, at the 3-month primary endpoint. Again, we don't have time to go into great detail, but of course, approved for psoriatic arthritis. They have more mild impact on the skin endpoints, although I will say if you follow their skin endpoints out to 6 months, you start to see almost etanercept-like efficacy around the 6-month time point. So probably not facing our most severe skin patients, but certainly some skin efficacy as well. So just another option to have for our patients. And I use that as a segue to some exciting new data from upadacitinib, which is a selective, a JAK1 selective JAK inhibitor from with this data presented at the at EULAR, if anyone was following along. And so this is pretty exciting data based on the numbers that we see here. You'll see the green 15 milligram dose, blue 30 milligram dose, and then sort of an active comparator arm here of adalimumab, 40 milligrams. I won't have time to go again into great detail, but just to give you a sense of pretty robust numbers here with regard to the ACR 20 endpoint at week 12. Here's ACR 50 data, ACR 70 data, and even some separation as early as week 2. It really looks to be one of our more robust JAK mechanisms in this space. So much more to come on this, but I think very exciting to have another mechanism that looks so robust in the psoriatic arthritis space. Here we have a little look, a glimpse into how they may fare with regard to PASI 75 and skin data at week 16. So you can appreciate that here at the different dose ranges, around 60% or so PASI 75. Again, you know, good numbers. I mean, maybe not the numbers of some of our newer targeted biologics in skin, but certainly, you know, a very reasonable numbers facing our psoriatic disease patients. And then some other important endpoints, including soft tissue disease, enthesitis, dactylitis, and the MDA, I mentioned earlier, that composite endpoint that faces multiple different domains of disease. And we can see, you know, pretty robust responses here at week 24. I think, you know, incredibly encouraging data for our patients with psoriatic arthritis. And so to wrap up, you know, how do we start to put all this together when we think about therapeutics? And so, you know, there are a lot of different concepts of disease activity, targets, even remission. The NPF has been so bold as to even talk about cure in this area. And so we know that patients are happiest when their skin and their joints are equally clear. And that's really how we maximize health-related quality of life. As we show here, you want your patients in the red area, which is best skin and joint control. And so there are a variety of algorithms that have looked at treat to target. This is one from the European group, Josef Smolin and others, that look at remission and low disease activity targets. And we had mentioned this earlier, which are what the minimal disease activity targets might look like, as well as other targets such as DAPSA. And again, we don't have time to go into great detail, but I think, you know, being familiar with these targets can really help us start to have a conversation with patients to get them to, you know, the sort of an optimal disease state. We have to remember all of the comorbidities when we think about our treatment options, and there are many. This is a nice graph from the GRAPPA group that sort of superimposes the mechanisms with the number of multiple comorbidities that happen in our psoriatic patients and look a little bit at compatibility. Again, we don't have time to go into detail. These are available on their website, and the references are here as well for looking up this particular publication. But I think it's helpful to just think about the multiple layers of decision processes that happen with our patients. And finally, it takes a team to really get these patients to the right care. And so, you know, we may fit here in the dermatology section with skin care and screening for psoriatic arthritis, the rheumatologist dealing with the psoriatic arthritis itself, but, you know, helping our patients to build a team around the multitude of potential comorbidities is really crucial. I think the primary care doctor is central in this story from a metabolic syndrome and cardiovascular standpoint. And otherwise, you can see where others fit in, and certainly the GI physician has their role in comorbid IBD and liver disease, for example. And feel free, you know, to have a look at one of our nonprofit organizations, PACMAN, that really discusses how combined clinics and combined care can really optimize treatment for patients. We have a variety of resources on our website for that. And so with that, I'll just say that, you know, back to our case, you know, what agents might you consider at this point? We've talked about efficacy. We've talked about mechanisms facing different domains. We've talked about how, very briefly, these treatments may face a variety of comorbidities. And so, you know, when you put this puzzle together, you really can start to think about what the right treatment might be for a patient and to inform a patient discussion. So with that, I will stop here. We're going to have some time for live Q&A, to take questions, to take feedback, only nice feedback. And then there'll also be some post-test question follow-up to the questions that you received at the beginning. So thanks for your attention.
Thank you, Dr. Merola. That was excellent. That was a great review of all the psoriatic data that we have. Just a little quick housekeeping. If you haven't already, please take a moment to answer polling questions. And this previous session was supported by an educational grant from AbbVie. So in terms of questions, so we have a few coming up here. Okay, so one of the first questions here says, what are your thoughts on using infliximab biosimilars in patients who responded well to Remicade in the past, then failed Remicade? This physician is saying that they've had a few successful cases in this way.
Yeah, it's an interesting question. We had that sort of session on biosimilars, and I think Adam Shefich brought this question up as well. This is a tough one. I guess the question of why they failed would drive might drive my answer, and whether or not their dose was really escalated and pushed maximally, to obtain that response. I think I've had somewhat of a preference for moving to other mechanisms, just because we have so many other mechanisms available to us now. And again, we have, while we don't have a ton of head-to-head data, I think it does make sense for patients at this point who have failed at least one TNF. Whereas in RA, I think there's some data for maybe considering a second or even third TNF before moving on to other mechanisms. I think in the psoriatic world, we have reason to move on to other mechanisms these days. That said, I think it's interesting that whoever's out there in listening in was able to capture or recapture patients on biosimilar infliximab. It's interesting. It's food for thought for us. I think that wouldn't have been my first knee-jerk reaction to go to that, but that is certainly interesting. I think the other thing, we didn't get to cover here, but there's actually quite good data for the IV golimumab study. I think it was GoVibrant and their data for psoriatic arthritis. And so that's another, if you're looking for an IV TNF solution, I think that's something else to consider in these subjects.
Okay, so we have another question. In the context of COVID-19, in someone who's not actively infected, would methotrexate be considered a relative contraindication as a new start? Would you go directly to a biologic? And thoughts on both psoriasis and psoriatic arthritis for this?
Yeah, so it's a great question. I mean, my quick review of the data so far has been that I'm not terribly worried about methotrexate in the context of COVID risk at present. We just put out a publication that should be available. It's certainly PubMedable right now, if that's a word, from the Medical Derm Society, looking at suggestions for use of our immunosuppressive and immunomodulatory agents throughout COVID. If you look at the data, I think from past experience, from MERS and SARS, as well as clinical trials data, in terms of upper respiratory infection and infection risk in general, I don't think of methotrexate as being particularly concerning, including in combination with biologics. So I wouldn't be too worried. That said, in the NYU data, if you look at the New England Journal publication of the data that came from NYU in terms of hospitalization risk and complication risk with COVID, they did find a small signal with methotrexate. I think it's a case-dependent discussion with individual patients. But my current thought is I'm not terribly worried about it at present.
Yeah, I agree.
I agree with that, Matalia.
I've started some people on it. Also, I feel like the doses we're using for the most part are quite low. For psoriasis, psoriatic arthritis, like 15 milligrams. But I do have, I have some patients on it, particularly like we're saying, like blistering disease patients. Sometimes you just have to use the drug, so
agreed.
I wouldn't consider it a contraindication. Okay, so we have one or two more questions here. Do you intend to treat patients with PSA for life, regardless of periods of symptomatic remission?
Well, that's a great question. So that comes to some of the concepts of what is remission, how do we define remission, and do we have a cure? We don't have a cure right now, so chronic disease equals chronic treatment is the discussion I have with most of my patients at present. We have a little bit more data in the rheumatoid arthritis realm, I think, as people know, for spacing out therapy, when someone is in sort of a true remission or deep remission. We have less of that information in psoriatic arthritis at present to drive our decision-making. I think for the most part, I'm still in the, chronic disease, chronic treatment mindset. And for the most part, I think patients who go on therapy stay on therapy. There is a movement to try to define what remission looks like, and what, we may even get to the point of talking about off-drug remission. But I think that's a big unmet need for our patients. I think it's a big unmet need, when we turn back to industry to ask what our needs are. I think remittive agents, true remittive agents and deep remission and such, is something that we still strive for. And we've made, and Mittal, you can comment on this, we've made big advances in the skin. And in psoriasis, we have some drugs that, boy, you know, you do wonder when the next dose should be because people are so clear. Right. PSA is a little different than that. But how do you manage metabolism? Not to ask, I know you're asking the questions here, right? But, you know, for the patients where they're completely clear on some of our newer mechanisms and agents, you know, what do you tell them about dosing? You tell them to stay on? Do you allow sort of spread out dosing, especially in COVID?
So I would say some of it, I ask the patient how they feel and we go through, you know, there is a very good possibility we could space this dosing out and you could be fine. And there's always the risk that we can space this dosing out and you can flare. And there's this small possibility that you may not get back to where you are. And I think with COVID, I have had patients opt to kind of space therapy a little bit, especially when we first had our big uptick here in the New York, New Jersey area. I had a lot of people hold off, but I think knowing that now we're looking at probably many months, most patients are opting to stick to the treatment plan and avoid the potential for flare.
Agreed.
But it's a hard discussion to have. Okay, so I think we are up on our time here, but so for everyone, there is still time to gain additional points for the Interacted IAS contest. So please head to the exhibit hall and we will see you in a little bit. Awesome. Thank you.